From there, she moved to Manhattan, which has a population somewhat larger, an intensity many orders of magnitude higher. And she's been on the faculty of Columbia University for the last decade. She's retained ties with all of her previous places and spent some summers doing radio astronomy in the Netherlands and sometimes going back to the very large array. This spring, she's visiting the University of California, Berkeley as a middle professor. And she's going to talk to us about the evolution of galaxies. And so it's a pleasure to introduce Dr. Jacqueline Van Gorder.
Okay, so what do physicists do? The first thing I can say, what do I do? Look at the t-shirt of Kevin, which is really, that's what it's about. Gas and galaxy evolution, that's what I work on and have been working on for many, many years. Not for my thesis, but after that. But so the other thing that physicists do is they travel a lot and they move around a lot. So when I did my PhD, I was living on a houseboat, actually below sea level, on Dutch Canal, and then I moved to 7,000 feet, where the VLA is, and it was a great move. And so there, as I said, I lived in a very small village called Dettel. So this is the Very Large Array, and I'm sure you've heard about it before. What is interesting about the Very Large Array is that it was actually came online in 1980, and that's when I moved there, just after it came online. And it was by far the best radio telescope in the world. And it still is by far the best radio telescope in the world. And it's about to be upgraded. They've been working on that for about 10 years. So in a few years, it will be a factor 10 better in almost every respect, which is really impressive. So that's it's a wonderful telescope. And in case you don't really know how it works, a radio telescope, so a telescope of this kind, combines the signal of all the different dishes. So each dish gets combined with all the other ones, and so then you register these signals, and you wait while the Earth rotates around. And so after 8 hours, all these telescopes have, if you would be sitting in a galaxy far away, these telescopes have traced out a circle. So in the end, this simulates a complete, very large dish. Right? That's the... And this idea sounds simple, but actually the person who invented it got a Nobel Prize for thinking about this idea. It's called aperture synthesis. So it's basically synthesizing the aperture. Now, since in radio astronomy, many signals are not variable with time, in fact, the things I study are not, you could also take data one day and then observe it again next day and combine the signals. And what you can also do is you can move the telescopes a few months later, and then have a different configuration and combine the data from the different configurations. And so, in fact, this telescope can move out to about here, to the mountains. It's a very large distance. So that's the largest configuration, and I lived in these mountains. So now, how do you move these telescopes? You use a transporter. Here it is. So the telescope... The transporter drives underneath the telescope and then lifts it up and goes on the railroad and it moves it somewhere far away. In the largest distances, it's about 30 kilometers. It takes almost a day to do. But so this happens every 3 months in the plains of St. Augustine. So this is it's a dry lake bed. A few thousand years ago, there was a lake here. It's at 7,000 feet. And along it runs Highway 60. So if you're lucky and drive on Highway 60 when the telescopes are being moved, there will be a sign on the highway, and it said, watch out, crossing telescopes. So that's what happens. Now, this telescope is also, it's actually, you might think that New Mexico is semi-desert, it's not that beautiful, but in fact it is. There's lots and lots of flowers, and in the end of August, the plains of St. Augustine are completely covered with wild sunflowers. So I really recommend that you go visit them. And there's, of course, also beautiful, beautiful sunsets. Okay, so this is the telescope closest to where I lived. This is actually Pinetown. I lived in Dettel. So I lived in this village, which had about 100 people, so they said. I never saw them all 100, but I think it's about that. And then from that on, I moved to Manhattan. Now, there's something interesting about this, not only for me that it was somewhat different, but actually the people in Dettol turned out to be slightly different from the people in Manhattan. Right? So in Dettol, they have these, they often wear these big hats against the sun, and they move pretty slowly, and they stop when they see you, and they talk with you. Well, if you go to Manhattan, people actually try to avoid eye contact, right? They move very fast, and everybody's very busy. Everybody gets up in the morning and is going to do something great, right? So there's an enormous difference. Now, interestingly, galaxies are just like that, right? So that is basically what I've been working on a long time. Galaxies are different whether they live in environments like Dettol or whether they are in places like Manhattan. And so this is a picture of a well-known cluster. It's the Virgo cluster. So this is a pretty dense environment. There's a big elliptical in the center. There are some big ellipticals here. And you see some disk galaxies, but most of it is actually ellipticals. Now, here's a close-up of that same thing. So here there's, you see these big ellipticals, and there's not much of these very nice spiral galaxies that you also know about. But if you move out a little bit further, then what you see is a beautiful spiral galaxy. So that is really already in a much lower density environment, right? Now, if we look at an even denser cluster, the Coma cluster, then you see there really is hardly any disk galaxies. These are all, they are called ellipticals, and some may be S0s. Most of them are actually ellipticals. So that's a very dense environment. Just think again of Manhattan. But if you look at a group of galaxies, this is what you see. So here you see a galaxy with a disk, another galaxy with a disk, and there's a little bit distorted, as if these galaxies are talking with each other, right? They're interacting. Here you see it again. There's nice spiral galaxies. There's actually, in this group, there is one elliptical galaxy, but most of them are disks. Okay, yet another example. Denser group, one elliptical, most of them are just disk galaxies. And so that is the question I'm going to talk about. Why is it? Right? So here is a summary of what galaxies look like, which already Hubble classified many, many years, almost a century ago now. So you have these elliptical galaxies. They're just round. Pretty. They seem pretty boring, but actually they're incredibly interesting. Then you have some S0s. These are galaxies with disks, but in the disks there's no gas and no spiral. Right? And then you have spiral galaxies where there's lots of star formation, there's lots of gas in the disk, and spiral galaxies with bars. So that is basically the difference. In high density environments, you get ellipticals and S0s. In low density environments, you get mostly spirals and hardly any ellipticals, maybe 10% or something. So now, why are ellipticals interesting? I have to tell you that too. Ellipticals are sort of round and sometimes a little bit flattened, but that is actually, they're not flattened because they rotate. The stars move on random orbits. So they just, these stars move around, and that's what an elliptical is. That's true for the big ellipticals. Disk galaxies, on the other hand, are all rotating. So they're very, very different. Spiral galaxies have these thin disks. You saw beautiful spiral petals. They have cold gas and they have star formation, current star formation. Ellipticals don't. S0 galaxies, they have disks, but they have no ongoing star formation, and they have, in general, very little cold gas, right? So there's a big difference between this and this, and actually, that is the biggest difference if you could go from a moderately density environment to a dense environment. So in the cores of clusters, you'll mostly find S0s, and you'll hardly find any spirals. And so the question is, is that nature or nurture? So that's basically what we've been thinking about for a long time. So again, we can go back to Dettol and Manhattan. Are people in Dettol different because they were born there and they just were very different kinds of people than the people who were born in Manhattan? Or is it people like me who moved from one place to another and they just changed? And actually, I went going back and forth, and each time when I went back and forth, I had to change my behavior. So that is what you call nurture. It's the environment that tells you that if I start avoiding eye contact in New Mexico, people think I'm crazy. But in Manhattan, it's a good thing to do. So are galaxies, what do galaxies do? Are they different because they were formed in different environments, or are they different because they entered different density environments and got affected by that environment? That's basically what my research is about. So this I already told you. The main difference between clusters and fields is this S0s versus spirals, right? So somehow it may be that if the environment affects galaxies, the spirals must be transformed in S0s. And that's something we can almost envision happening. So one obvious thing spirals have to do, they have to lose their gas, because S0s don't have cold gas and don't have star formation. So how could we do that? So then the question really becomes, when and where do galaxies, so this is now more a modern view, that galaxies are really not isolated systems. They're continually accreting gas. And this is true for isolated galaxies that live in filaments or in voids or in groups. But at some point, when they come close to clusters, they clearly stop accreting gas. And at some point, they really lose that cool gas and they stop forming stars. So we think that might be an evolutionary sequence. Question is, how does that happen? So now here, I want to show you, and that's sort of the picture that was also one of the pictures on the t-shirt. If you look at a galaxy in the optical, it looks very different from when you look at a galaxy in a neutral hydrogen gas. So neutral hydrogen emits a line at radio wavelengths, 21 centimeter. That's the line that I observe with the VLA, and I observe it with a telescope in India, with telescopes in the Netherlands and in Australia. Basically, all my work is on this neutral hydrogen gas. So in fact, the galaxies in the field look very, very different when you look at the gas, right? They are much, much bigger. These two pictures are on the same scale. And I have some other examples just to really convince you of this. Here's another galaxy. This is the optical picture. This is where all the stars are. This is where the gas is, right? So that's a random galaxy somewhere in the field. It has a huge gaseous envelope, and this gas can be used for all sorts of interesting things to learn about the evolution of the galaxy. Here's another example. Okay, so keep this in mind. If you look outside clusters, somewhere in the field, you see spiral galaxies, and that is what their gas distribution looks like. It's much, much larger than in the optical. Okay, now, you can wonder what happens when you come close to clusters. Now this is maybe a little bit hard to see, but these are pictures of 18 different clusters where people have looked just at the gas content of the spirals in these clusters. And for that they actually used the Arecibo telescope. They just looked at the total gas content of the spirals. And in each of these clusters, the circle indicates the center of the cluster. Right, that is where you see all the S0s and ellipticals, and you don't see many spiral galaxies. But they looked at spirals pretty far out, actually amazingly far out. Right? And so they looked for each of these spirals at the gas content, and then they compared it to what the gas content would be for a spiral that was very far away from a cluster, so in the field. So they looked at spirals of the same morphological type, actually, and they were just seeing, are these galaxies in some way affected by their environment? And so this is actually the pretty surprising result. So this little circle that I showed you goes out to here, right? It's one Abel radius, so as we said, which is really the center of the cluster. And this is what we plot here. This is all the data. And what we plot here is basically whether these galaxies have less neutral hydrogen than they would have compared to the field. So when you go to about zero, actually, they are normal. They're the same as in the field. So here you see zero, there's a spread around it, but if you go about twice the distance of that circle, these galaxies have normal gas content. But if you go closer in, it's a small effect, but these galaxies really have less gas. So this already demonstrates that galaxies near clusters seem statistically to have less gas, but there is still a huge spread in it. Now, of course, we want to know how that happens. And so this is actually a pretty recent result. This was found in 2001. And what was surprising is that you even see the effect well outside the little circle that I showed. That was something totally, totally new. Okay, so now we can think about how do we want to change the galaxy. And so basically we want to remove the gas. And we can think of many, many ways of doing that. And so here, just three things are mentioned. Ram pressure stripping is when the hot gas interacts with the cold gas. So there's in clusters, there's a lot of hot gas in the center. If a galaxy moves through it, it can remove the cold gas from the galaxy in the outer part, only in the outer part. Harassment is something that's very popular these days. It's basically the effect that if a galaxy goes through a cluster, it has many fast encounters, again, just like Manhattan, it has many fast encounters with lots of people. So you don't actually interact with them, right? You just walk by and you look at the floor. You don't look at them. But just by going by many of these galaxies, each time you get a little pull, and in the end you can actually pull out the outer parts of the galaxy. So that would affect the stars and the gas. Now starvation is a third thing, and that is, this goes back to this more modern idea that galaxies really aren't isolated systems. They continue to accrete gas. So there is still a reservoir of gas around them, like our Milky Way. There's still gas dribbling in at a very slow pace, but that provides fuel for star formation in the Milky Way. Now the idea of starvation is that when a galaxy enters a denser environment, that reservoir gets removed. So it still has gas, it will still form stars, but at some point, the gas that was there is being used up in star formation and the reservoir is taken away. So it's a more slow process and it's called starvation. Okay, so this is just, I want to show you one picture. This is again the Virgo cluster. And I want to emphasize, here is a picture of the hot gas in the cluster. Right, so now this is a picture of only gas. This is X-ray emission. There's gas there for more than 1,000,000 degrees. And this is a picture of the gaseous disks of the spiral galaxies around this cluster. And the spiral galaxies are all blown up by a factor 10 to make it more visible. But so what I'm talking about is the interaction between this gaseous disk with this very hot gas. Okay, now, I had a student who recently finished a PhD, Eric Chung. And not only is he a very good scientist, he is also somewhat of an artist. And so she is writing a thesis about the effect of the impact of the cluster on the galaxies. And so I said, well, you should really have one chapter in your thesis describing what the environment can do to galaxies. So describe the different mechanisms. So she disappeared, and about a month later, she came back with this picture. So here it is. So this is a galaxy. In yellow is white, is the stars. Blue is the cold gas in the galaxy, so that usually is arranged in a nice disk. And purple is the ICM. And so I'll now demonstrate what different kind of interactions you can have. So this is the first. I talked about this already, right? You see this galaxy looks pretty unhappy. So here is the hot ICM. This galaxy is falling into the ICM, and the ICM is pushing out the cold gas out of the outer parts of the disk. So that's what's called ram pressure stripping. It doesn't affect the stars at all. It pushes out the gas, and so you might, if you're lucky, really see it leaving the galaxy. Okay. Okay. Now this is a really poor galaxy. It's so this gas is hot. The ICM is maybe 100 million degrees, certainly more than 1,000,000. And so it basically, through conduction actually, it heats up the cold gas. So in that case, you will see the cold gas sort of disappearing from the whole disk. So the whole disk might get less gas, less total gas. So that's thermal evaporation. Now, of course, galaxies can also have encounters. And that's again, so in Dettol we had these slow encounters. And you would really have an interaction, exchange of information. In clusters, that is less likely to happen because galaxies move very fast relative to each other. But if they would happen to have a slow encounter, then they would be tidally distorted, and you would get two of these big tails, both in the stars and in the gas, right? It's gravity, so it affects both. Very different from these other interactions. So that's just a galaxy-galaxy interaction. Okay, then there is another thing that has to do basically with the potential of the cluster. So when a galaxy falls into the cluster, it enters a strong gravitational field from the entire cluster. So it is possible that a galaxy gets a little bit stressed out by that potential field, and it might even lose some of its outer parts. And again, it would both the stars and the gas would be affected. So lots of things can happen in clusters. And then, okay, this is the picture of the starvation. So this is what I mentioned before. Imagine that this galaxy had this large reservoir of gas that was slowly dribbling in. If that gas reservoir gets removed as the galaxy enters the cluster, then this galaxy, in the end, is left with no interstellar medium left because it keeps forming stars. So it will starve. And then finally, there is this harassment, which is where they, so that is basically the effect of many fast encounters with other galaxies in the cluster. So they will all pull on this galaxy. It's somewhat similar to the tidal truncation. It's just basically part of the galaxy can get pulled out, and so it will. So Airy's conclusion was, life is tough for a galaxy in a cluster. It definitely is. Okay, so this is the picture again. So now this was actually Airy's thesis, and she got she won the first international image contest on NRAO, which the National Radio Astronomy Observatory now has an international contest every year. You can submit your most beautiful picture, and they select pictures, and if you win, you're very happy, of course. So she won the first. So this is basically a summary of her thesis. Here is the X-ray gas in Virgo. And so these are all these galaxies that she imaged in neutral hydrogen. And basically the idea was, let's see what is happening to these galaxies that are entering the cluster. Now, one other thing I want to point out here is that although you think maybe of Virgo as a nice, relaxed, big cluster, in fact, it has a big core here. This is M87, one of the nearest really big ellipticals. But it has other groups or subclones falling in. This is M86 with some galaxies around it, and here is M49. So in fact, it's a cluster that's still assembling. And that is what is sort of new in these results, that we are now looking at what the assembly of the cluster does to the galaxies. So here I'm showing you some examples. So this is now in gray, is the hydrogen extent of these galaxies, and the blue ellipses are the optical extent. So now remember the pictures that I showed you before. In the field, you saw this H1 that was much, much larger than the galaxy. In the center of the cluster, or at least close to the core, we see H1 disks that are much smaller than the optical extent. So that is really, really weird, right? That indicates that something has happened to these galaxies. Now, we also see further out, we actually see galaxies that have H1 extents that are sometimes even larger than the optical. Here's an example, there's other examples, and sometimes they're sort of comparable. Now, another thing that we see that's somewhat confusing is we see some small gas disks very far away, which I actually will not talk about much today, but I can always answer questions if you have questions. Okay, so I want to show you a close-up of this galaxy. So this is the size of the optical, there is the H1. Here it is. So actually, I'm also only showing you part of the optical. It extends actually much, much further than this, and in blue you see the H1 disk. Now, thinking of all the mechanisms that we mentioned, this really looks like ram pressure stripping to me. It doesn't affect the stars, and the H1 disk is much smaller than the stellar disk. Now, this is in the center of the cluster, and actually there you expect that the pressure of the hot gas is enough to do this. So if a galaxy moves rapidly through the center, its somewhat plausible that you remove the hot gas. You can make a calculation and it's perfectly okay. So this is a prime example of something that's happening there. That it's really, you expect it to happen and it happens. Now, we can also look in the low density outer parts, and there you see something else that's really interesting. So let's look at those galaxies. They're really in the outer parts before they enter the dense core. So here are some overlays. Now this, okay, I think this is an amazing system. So here, the photograph is the optical, right? So this is the extent of the stars. This is the extent of the neutral hydrogen. So it is much, much larger. And here, what you see is, this is the optical. Here there is sort of an optical tidal tail. There's another companion. And again, this is the gas. So this looks like some sort of interaction, right? It's a galaxy-galaxy interaction, probably. It looks like a merger remnant. Now, here's another galaxy that has this, a very small optical size and an H1 envelope that's sort of not even completely aligned with the optical, like this. So there seem to be, so here you see basically the orientation of the optical for these galaxies, and what you see is that in all cases there is there's some misalignment between the gas and the optical. So from that we might actually conclude, and there is, this is for the people who are used to looking at velocity fields, these are isovelocity constants, and basically the only thing you need to see in this is that it's very, very warped. It doesn't look straight, which is what you would get for a galaxy that's rotating. So this is a highly distorted galaxy. So the conclusion from this is that we are seeing in the outer parts, first of all, they're very, very gas-rich, but we are seeing examples of galaxy-galaxy interactions, and we still probably see examples of gas accretion. So if you go really far out in the cluster, you might still see that. But at some point, that has to stop, right? Because right in the center, we see galaxies with very small H1 disks, and we know most of the galaxies are zeros that have no gas left. Okay, now this is a picture of something that's really totally new. We are very excited about this. We found this maybe 2 or 3 years ago. So now we are looking at galaxies that are a little bit further out. In fact, they seem to be just about at the edge of the hot gas, right? They may be just entering the cluster. And these galaxies all have extensions in neutral hydrogen, right? And one of the interesting things is that these extensions are all pointing away from the center of the cluster, right? And so here you see overlays. You see, again, in blue you see the gas, and in red you see the stars now. And so from these pictures, I want to give you one. So when we found this, we said, well, what is this? Why are all these stars pointing away from the center of the cluster? Well, that suggests that there is something, since they're all about at the same distance and they're all pointing away, that there is some global mechanism at work that is affecting them all in the same way. So maybe our first reaction was that it has to be the cluster potential. But it turns out that effect is about a factor of 1,000 too weak. It can't do it. So then the other possibility is that it is still an interaction with the gas in the cluster. But at these positions, the gas density is very, very low. So it is a little bit surprising. But still, we think that's the case. And the reason we think that's the case is because, again, here is an example, this galaxy. Here you see the stars from the stellar disk, and the gas is removed from that point of the disk. While here, you see the stellar disk still sticking out, but the gas is being pushed away. So again, there is a mechanism at work that affects the gas and not the stars, right? And so that is actually true for all of them. This, here it is very, very clear. Here you also see there's actually a little point where the gas is pushed out of the disk, and here it's very clear. And the tail points away from them. So we concluded that it still has to be a Rampere's disturbing. And in fact, when you do the calculation, it turns out it can work. And the reason it can work is because it only removes the gas that is really in the outer outer parts of the galaxy. So the pull back from the galaxy is not that strong, and it's very diffuse gas. But so what we are seeing is now that already further from the core of the cluster, galaxies are beginning to be affected. which was this big question. Why is that? Why can they already be affected that far away? So that was really, really, really exciting. So what we think is that these galaxies, since their tails are all pointing away, are radially falling into the cluster. And so for the first time, they're actually losing their gas. The gas is being removed by ram pressure. Maybe there are some gravitational interactions to those. But now, so those were all galaxies that were pretty far away, but they were still close enough that this was possible. And the gas is only removed from the very outer parts. But actually, we also have one galaxy that is very different. It's also far out in the cluster, but it's much more affected. And this is the galaxy. It's NGC 4522. It's one of our favorite galaxies. It has, in the optical, a perfectly undisturbed disk. These are old stars, sort of reddish disk. It looks like a perfectly normal disk. This is what the gas looks like, right? So if you would see that galaxy, you would ask what's going on. You say, well, someone is pushing that gas out of the disk, right? It's totally different from what you see in the field, where you would have gas just sitting on top of the disk and then maybe extending a lot further. Here, it's removed in both parts of the disks, and then it's really out of the plane. So it looks as if it's being ram pressure stripped now. But this galaxy is even further away than the ones I showed before. And actually, it's very surprising that that there would be enough ram pressures there to remove the gas. So this is another optical image of that galaxy from the Sloan Digital Sky Survey. And here is a Galax image, which shows Galax is a UV satellite, and it shows that there is actually some star formation in the gas that's being pulled out, both in the near and far UV. Okay, so this is so interesting that we decided we also wanted to get more information about the stellar population in the disk. So we did integral field spectroscopy right here, just at the edge. Here the gas is stripped, and here there are stars. Now, if we look at the stellar population, so it's interesting, we don't see the youngest stars, but we see stars that were formed a few hundred million years ago, right? So these are A stars. But we don't see the very youngest stars. So from this, we can estimate when star formation stopped, right? The youngest stars are not there, but slightly older stars are still there. So we know when star formation stopped. So we estimate, we can estimate when the gas was removed, right? And it turns out to be a few hundred million years ago, at most. Now, we also look at the kinematics of the gas, and this might be a little bit hard to understand. This is the kinematics of the gas in the disk of that galaxy. This is the kinematics of the gas beyond the disk, so outside the disk. And what you should note here is that the gas that's above the disk is actually being accelerated. And from that we conclude that it's right now still being pushed out of the galaxy. So it's not something that's falling back, it's being pushed out. Which again, I just want to make a lot of points saying that this galaxy is undergoing pressure right now, despite the fact that it's pretty far out. This is another indication. There is enhanced radio continuum emission, which means that there are shocks there, that there are electrons being accelerated. And it's also, here this is an indication that they have been accelerated pretty recently. So again, that gives you some idea that something is going on right now. And then finally, so we have one theorist in the collaboration who made a model of ram pressure stripping for this galaxy. They said, well, the only way I can make this work and make it look what we see, like what we actually observe, is if it was stripped very recently. So again, I think there's no time here, but he found a few hundred million years ago. So why is that so interesting? The reason that's interesting is that, so this is again a picture of the Virgo cluster. The contours are now the X-ray emission. So this is where the hot gas is. Here is the center of Virgo. This is where this galaxy is, NGC 4522. It just seems to be entering the very diffuse part of the hot gas, right? And there would be, if you just see this, you say that's not enough to be RAM pressure's tripping. No, the pressure isn't high enough. So then you say, well, okay, there's an easy explanation. This galaxy went through the center and is now on its way out, so it got stripped here. But you can just look at how long it would take if it would be traveling in the plane of the sky, which it probably isn't. It would take at least 700 million years. So that is way too long. I mean, star formation stopped about 100 million years ago. And the model also said it was stripped about 100 million years ago. So there's a real problem here. And so we think we found a solution of the problem. And that is this picture. So this is now a picture, again, of the hot gas in Virgo. Here is where the Virgo cluster is. There is the center of the Virgo cluster. Our galaxy is sort of here. And here is another subgroup falling into the Virgo cluster. It's the M49 group. So here you see the gas is very hot. The colors indicate temperature now. And here you see there's lots and lots of temperature structure. So actually, from the X-ray observations of this group, you can, by looking at the morphology of the X-ray, you can derive that this group is falling in with a velocity of 1300 kilometers per second, which is a pretty high velocity. And you can see that from the shape of the bow shock. So we can also see that the temperature structure has been really affected. So what we think is happening here is that this subcluster is falling into the cluster, and the intercluster medium is sloshing around because there is this addition of high velocity intercluster medium. And so if you just increase the velocities of the ICM with about a factor 3, all of a sudden your RAM pressure will go up by almost a factor 10. It goes as V squared. So that way you can actually create high RAM pressure even far out from the cluster. And so that is basically what, that is the big new thing. And I think it might be an explanation for that we see galaxies already being affected far out from the cluster's core. It happens when subclusters fall in. So if you look actually even further down, this is in this group that's coming from down south, falling into the Virgo, you see two galaxies that have enormous tails in H1. So again, it's galaxies falling into the cluster with these tails pointing away from Virgo. Now, we can also look, so here is M87, and we now go to the clump in the, yes?
So are you saying that you think that the motion of the subcluster has already sort of gone through and it's on that plot going southward?
No, I think that the subcluster is still falling in, and so you actually, it's just the encounter of that hot ICM with the ICM of the Virgo itself that's doing it. And that's, it's, so this is again, in simulations people start finding these large sloshing motions in the X-ray gas, which are very hard to measure. There's two claims that people have seen 1,000 kilometers per second or something, but that's
So you think if we could measure the transverse velocity,
yeah,
the velocity
it would be about
the sky of those particular galaxies, you think along with that subcluster they're all going this way?
Exactly. Yeah. And I thought those two tails probably have gone through the class group. Yeah. And so now I'm looking at another group. So here is M87 and this is the M86 group. And so this group is falling in from the back into the Virgo cluster. So it's moving sort of in this direction, but then falling in from the back. So there we actually found some amazing things too. And this is the first amazing thing, which nobody had really remarked upon. But here in color, you see again the hot gas. And so when I was looking at this picture, I thought, well, here is M87. This is not very symmetric around M87. In fact, it's elongated in this direction. This is definitely not very symmetric around the other elliptical. It's elongated in that direction. So even in the hot gas, you already see some elongation, as if something is going on. Now, we also found one of the longest tails ever, which is this tail in H1, and it's really nice. Again, we can, from making an overlay of the gas on the galaxy, we see that it has to be RAM pressure stripping. Here it's moved out of the disk, and here you see this enormous tail, which, again, the most impressive picture of that is this. In blue you see the tail, and there you see the elliptical galaxies. So there's a lot of cold gas, actually, in that subgroup, and there might even be enough to have some star formation, which there's lots of evidence that that may actually be going on. So this is one spectacular thing. And now I go to a galaxy that is actually up here somewhere. Here it is. Yeah, so this is, again, this group. So the huge tail was here. So here's another galaxy that's part of that group. And that turns out to be also very interesting if you look at what's happening to the gas. So that galaxy is sort of falling in the plane of the sky, and you see again, you see that the H1 is being stripped out of the optical disk in grayscale, and it's elongated in this direction. The radio continuum shows the same thing. And actually, if you leak, so from the radio continuum, you can say, well, it must be falling in like this. So it's experiencing a pressure that's in that direction. And optically, you see actually striking examples of this. So this is now dust plumes coming out of this disk. First of all, you see there is a dust lane in this disk. And here, all the dust has already been removed by the Rand pressure. But you still see these plumes of dust coming probably from molecular clouds that are being destroyed right now. And they all point sort of in the same direction as the wind. So we think that's very good indication that this wind. So this is another example of, you might wonder, is Virgo the only cluster like that? No, no. If you look at the Coma cluster, again here you see the contours are for the X-ray, and these are contours of the gas in the galaxies. So again, you see outside the core of the cluster, you see galaxies with lots and lots of gas. When they enter the X-ray, here you see an overlay of the optical and the H1. It really starts losing its gas. So what this suggests is that galaxies, as they enter the cluster core, they get affected by the hot gas. And so if they really go through it, they lose almost all of it, which would make it possible to let them slowly evolve into S0 galaxies. But so one of the interesting things is that they get affected as these subgroups fall in. And so now what I want to show you is some simulations, which a few years ago I got a cosmological colleague at Columbia who makes simulations of the formation of clusters. And so when I saw these simulations, I all of a sudden really understood what was going on. So I want to show you that. So this is the first. So first I'm going to show you really cosmology. So this starts very back, way back in time. And first you see, and I'm only going to show you the hot gas. And what I show is the temperature of the gas. So if it becomes, if it is red, it's really not very high temperature. If it's black, it's the cold gas in the galaxies. And if it becomes yellow, it's very, very hot. And so you have to just notice what happens when you start forming this cluster. So let's see. There it goes. Okay, so you see some gas is accumulating here. Some gas is accumulating here. Yeah, that's even better. Yes, and it's sort of, it's less than a million degrees, but it's pretty hot. You see some dark spots, that is actually galaxies. Right now, this is an area that's about 8 times the core of the cluster that I showed you before, the small circle. So here you see 2 clumps forming. The temperature of the gas gets really much higher. And notice when the 2 clumps get together, the hot temperature rushes out. So there's actually shocks moving out to very, very large distances. Right? And that's what really got me excited, because that means that each time a clump falls in, you affect a huge area around the cluster. So the idea is really that each time you have a clump fall in, the hot temperature goes out to large distances and it affects the galaxies before they fall in. So this was the temperature. Now I want to show you a high resolution simulation of the same cluster. It starts at a much more recent time. And instead of showing you the temperature, I show you the density of the gas. So here we go. And so white is highest density. So there it goes. So now you see again, you see these filaments of gas coming in. And then you see these white dots, which are galaxies. And look, they're losing some of their gas. Right. And of course, this is, so the previous one, you saw this very non-uniform distribution. But in the density distribution, you get something that really looks much more like a relaxed cluster. Right? You see very hot gas around the central galaxy, and you see these small ones falling in. Right. So now, having the advantage of having a colleague in your department is that I could say, well, actually, what I'm really interested in is what the neutral hydrogen does. And so you never see simulations of neutral hydrogen in clusters. But he said, okay, I can make that for you. So the next movie is showing just the neutral hydrogen gas. Okay? And again, it shows the density of the gas. So there we go. So there it goes. So you see that there are these very large filaments. And then you also see that right in the center, they just... there's not much hydrogen left, right? They lose most of it very, very quickly. But then there are these large things in the outskirts. So there it goes. So almost nothing left in the center, but there are some very large tails left at T equals zero. So now, the final movie I want to show you is about the metals. And the reason I show you that is because it is the best way to see how galaxies lose their gas. So galaxies usually have a lot of metals in their interstellar medium. The intercluster medium has less of them. So when you strip the gas of a galaxy, you add metals to the intercluster medium. And so in this case, white will be a high metal abundance. So there we go. So the white dots are again galaxies, and see, you see these huge tails. If you ever doubt that Rempress is trapping here, you see it, right? So actually the interesting thing is it gives a very non-uniform distribution in the intergalactic medium, which is something that should observationally be tested at some point. Okay, so that actually is the end of my talk. So what I wanted to convince you of is that in the assembly of clusters, you affect galaxies as they enter the clusters. So that might be part of the explanation why galaxies in clusters are very different from galaxies in the field. Okay.